Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for coming. We're extremely delighted this afternoon to have with us one of IBM's senior leaders, and we would like to thank her for being here. Lita Sanford's career at IBM began in 1975. I know you guys are trying to count backwards, but it's about 39 years. When she joined the company as an engineer after graduating from St. John's University. Her first experience, however, was not as an engineer. She was a businesswoman, business kid, as you say, when she was selling potatoes from her parents' farm in Eastern Long Island on a stand. And that's why the Eastern Long Island potatoes became so famous. So that's attributed to Lita. So after the potato thing, and throughout her career, has assumed one big job after another and exceeded expectations in every step of the way. As an executive leader, she was instrumental in reinventing IBM's flagship mainframe computer into an open system and in driving IBM's comeback in storage technology. So these were two major transformations that IBM now is very well known of breaking new ground in. For the past decade, she has led IBM's very successful company-wide transformation efforts. And therefore, transformation is a central theme in her career, and one could say that transformation is in her DNA. So her accomplishments have been well recognized throughout the business world. She has been named one of the 50 most influential women in business by Fortune magazine, and one of the 10 most influential women in technology by Working Woman magazine. Linda is the former chair of the Business Council of New York State, and has been instrumental in helping forge successful partnerships among the private and public sector and higher education. She serves on the board of trustees of the State University of New York and St. John's, and also is a member of the National Academy of Engineering, where she has been a longtime colleague of our own, Bill Rouse. Thank you, Bill, for making the connection with Linda. And bringing it here to us. We're pleased that Linda could join us today to share some of her personal story and her observations on what she sees happening in the global marketplace and the implications for our next generation of leaders. At noon, Linda and I and Susan, and thank you, Susan, for all your efforts also, and the committee, ladies, there, and the men that we have in the committee for the Provost Lecture Series. And we had a discussion with about a dozen of our student leaders. And it was kind of one of these magic moments that makes you feel good about having an administrative position at Stevens, that you can see our product, most of them were seniors, as a matter of fact, go toe-to-toe with Linda and ask her very pointed questions. And it was a sheer pleasure. So thank you. Let me welcome you to Stevens, Linda, and let's everybody welcome you to Stevens. Thank you for coming.
Okay, well, thank you very, very much, Dr. Korfiadis. And I have to tell you, I am just so delighted to be here. I have never, unfortunately, but boy, I will come back, never been to Stevens before. I don't think I've even been to Hoboken before. And I live only across the way. So, you know, shame on me that it took so long for me to get here. But I thank my good friend Bill for the kind invitation and all of you for being here today. You have an absolutely fabulous place. The school, the campus, the programs, and what a view. What a view, right? So again, I really do very much appreciate the opportunity here. What I'd like to do is, and one other thought here, is I very much enjoyed that conversation at lunch today. Sharp, and I'm sure the students that were there are a great representation of the entire school, both the students as well as the faculty here and the administration. So you have a lot very much to be proud of. They were stimulating questions. They were great questions. I gave them all my card because I'd love to hire them all tomorrow. So great work here. So I would like to keep this as informal as possible. And I will save enough time, hopefully at the end, for questions. But if something just, you know, urges you and you want to pop up and ask a question or ask for clarification or come up with an idea, please don't hesitate to jump in there. I thought I'd start with a little bit about my own background, just to give you a little bit more color than the potato farming there. But and also then touch on what's happening in technology, because it is affecting everything, what we do, how we do it around the world. And we are on the crest here of a very, very, I think, foundational change. On the crest of a foundational change here in the market, in the world. So the good news is the students here are all going to be leaders through this next big phase of change here. So let me just add a little bit, if I could, this is my leadership journey map. I had my entire senior team together, about 6 months ago or so, and I asked them all to create their own individual journey maps. And both personal and professional throughout their lives here. So this was mine. And I did grow up, it's my grandparents' potato farm on Eastern Long Island. And I'm the oldest of five girls, so I have four sisters. We're all math and science majors, believe it or not. All math and science majors. And thank you. And I do think it started from that farm, by the way, because we had to sell, you know, the vegetables on the farm stand in front of the house. And I remember asking my grandfather, you know, Grandpa, if it's, you know, $2.50 and they give us $5, what do we do? He'd say, figure it out, right? Which we did. But I think it gave us that first sense of, you know, we could go do it. We could make it happen. Right? And I think we reinforced everything that we did along the time from that point in time onwards. The other thing is I actually have two children of my own. Both are grown and working in Manhattan, and I have two granddaughters. So we have other than my one son, every one of us has girls. We're a family of just girls, right? And good thing we're all math and science majors here. And, you know, I think if one of the things that our parents instilled in all of us very early was that, you know, if we worked hard, you know, we could do anything we wanted to do. And so, you know, it doesn't matter what it is, but what our interests were, and if we believed in it and really wanted to succeed and make a difference and worked hard at it, we could do it there. And so that was, I think, you know, the start we all had very, very early on in our lives here. I won't take you through all of these things along the way, but by the way, math and music do go together, I do believe. So all of us are into music and piano and singing and everything else along the way there. And more I'm seeing it at universities where they're bringing the sciences and the math and the arts together, because I do think there's a lot of synergy between both of those there. And then I started with IBM in 1975, as you heard here, and I actually started in Lexington, Kentucky. I'm from New York, you know, born, bred, and raised. Started in Lexington, Kentucky on the electric typewriter. That's what one looks like, because you probably have never seen one, most of you here, some of you here at least. Started on electric typewriter, and what I was doing then was simulation modeling of the typing environment. How much text, how much video, how much mixed, and really optimizing, you know, the performance of that electric typewriter to be efficient operational efficiency for the typist here. And then I moved from there, and I went into Boulder, Colorado for about 10 years, and then back to New York for the rest of my 39-year career here. So it's been a lot of very interesting, exciting experiences. Yes, 39 years with one company. Honestly, I feel like I've had multiple jobs. Happens to be all IBM, but I've had so many different experiences along the way here. I think then, as I came back, I had my first executive leadership job here in New York. And it was really after we had hit that proverbial brick wall, if some of you remember that, in early 90s. IBM did hit that proverbial brick wall, although it felt real at the time, where we were actually losing money. But that was when we just decided we had to transform ourselves, reinvent ourselves. And so we brought in, the first time ever, chairman and CEO from outside of IBM, Lou Gerstner. And he had asked me to help reinvent the mainframe business. What had hit the brick wall was the mainframe business, our core, our very being. And so I had the opportunity back in those early 90s to help transform it and turn it around. And I honestly, as I look back, it was a pivotal point in my career. I honestly believe you learn the most through some of these very, very tough situations, right? It had to be reinvented. It was the core of our very business, of the entire IBM company. And what got us to that success was not going to get us back to success going forward. We had to think differently. We had to work differently. And that change in how we would approach turning that business around was much more than just a technology and a business model change. It was all about a cultural change. A cultural change. How do we get people to think differently, to embrace a new world? Not fight change, but embrace it to take us into the future here. And since that time, as I said, very pivotal, I spent 5 years there. So I got to not only help lay out what the new strategy would be to transform that business, but to actually execute that strategy and see if it worked. Learned a ton through that experience here. And then after that, I moved on to other roles, including running sales. Now I'm a mathematician and a technologist at heart, so sales was like, whoa, a very big change. But I learned something there as well, that I think the two, one is how to transform and how to think about things differently, take the world to a new place, that mainframe experience. But when you run sales, you also get that customer view. And you build those client relationships. And you never transform just for transformation's sake. You transform because your market, your clients, need you to. Their businesses are changing. And you, if you're going to be relevant to them, you need to be able to change what you offer, how you offer it to those clients. So both of those experience, I've had lots of different jobs, but those two stand out in terms of what I learned the most. And I think going forward, both of those are exactly what we're all going to need to be comfortable with in the future. Change is inevitable, it's constant, it's unpredictable, it's moving faster and faster. On one hand, clients with this all new technology around cloud and mobile and social, they want you to know them not as, the corporate name, but as, you Greg, you John, you Judy, right, as a member of that corporation. And so knowing clients, understanding their needs, their capabilities, their challenges, and responding to those, I think are two very, very important capabilities going forward here. So about 12 years ago is when I took on this current role, which is leading our internal reinvention or transformation of the IBM company. And honestly, when our current chairman at the time, Sam Palmisano, had asked me to take on this role, I said no. I said, I run P&Ls, because I ran many of the businesses in the company over the course of the year. I run P&Ls. But obviously he convinced me, and I tell you, it has been another wonderful experience here to understand how the corporation as a whole works, the enterprise, and how do you transform that with its many pieces and parts and different offerings along the way here. And so when I started that, I looked back on some of these other experiences, like in the mainframe world, to really look at the lessons learned that I learned back then and how I could apply them if they made sense into this bigger enterprise-wide transformation. So it is much bigger. IBM has 400,000 employees. 400,000. And we're in about 170 countries around the world. So, you know, turning around that kind of a ship is certainly an exciting challenge, and it is. And we're also 103 years old, right? 103 years old. And, you know, the reason I believe we are 103 is because we have continuously transformed ourselves. And I think those companies who don't, it's just a matter of time before they disappear. And I think the other additional thing that's happening now around transformation, it's not just transforming the company, how it works, its business model, what it offers, but it's also a transformation of the people who work in that company. Your skills, going forward, you're going to learn new skills many, many times throughout your careers. Many, many times. And I think this is one of the most exciting things, because you, whether you work for one company or many companies, you're going to find there's a continuous, you know, new challenge, new opportunity that will be ahead of you here. So just a little bit of my personal background here. I did not script it that way 39 years ago. But I honestly do, when I look back, say, boy, it was one of the best experiences I've had and learned from along the way here. Okay, so let me shift a little bit and move on to some of the technology changes and trends that are happening out there, just because I think, as I said earlier, they're going to have a fundamental impact on the world and how the world operates and how we as individuals operate in that world. And so here's the first big shift. We talk about three shifts. And one is about data. That's the first shift that's happening. And a few of us talked about that just a little bit ago. Data. There is more data in this world today than you can shake a stick at. And you all know that. Every discussion today that I have about changes in technologies do start with data. We're inundated with data. What do we do with all this data? Data promises, in our view, to be for the 21st century what the steam power was for the 18th century, what electricity was for the 19th century, and what oil was for the 20th century. It is the world's new natural resource. Not just raw data, it's data that you can turn into insight, right? The world today is generating data at a rate of 2.5 billion gigabytes a day. 2.5 billion gigabytes a day. 80% of all the data in the world today has been created just in the past 2 years, right? And it comes from multiple sources, from images, from audio, from billions of RFID tags, sensors that are on everything from cars to, you know, you name it, from billions of blogs, texts, posts, tweets. Data is just coming at us from all directions. So we are awash in data. And as I said, as a result, every client that I meet with already has a big data program in place. And the thought is, how do I harness the data to give me insight, to help me make better decisions, to predict before I even see the change happening in my marketplace? Now, to meet this particular demand, IBM also, we see this, we've been investing very heavily in what we call big data and analytics. We've actually done a number of acquisitions in this field. We have some 15,000 analyst consultants in the company and about 400 PhDs in math and statistics in our research labs, creating the new algorithms and the new capabilities to harness this data. And two-thirds of the work that is done in the 12 different IBM research laboratories around the world are all around data and analytics, two-thirds of it. And also moving not just into analyzing that data for insight, but now moving into cognitive computing. Now, what is that? So you may have all seen about 3 years ago, if you watch Jeopardy on TV, right? Our computer called Watson, named after our founder, right? He defeated the two all-time champions of the Jeopardy game. And since then, we have been continuing to program Watson, not just to play games, but to solve real-world problems. And we've been training it in medicine, healthcare, training it in finance, training it in retail, feeding it all this information. And earlier this year, we actually created what we call our new Watson Group. It's our business that is focused on commercializing Watson cognitive capabilities. And they've set up a shop, by the way, in Silicon Alley, Astor Place, so just on the other side of the river here. If you haven't been there, you know, I guess Soho, NoHo area, go see it. Go see it. It's really exciting. In fact, I do have a picture of it here. It's that building. It's where the old Cooper Union used to be. Right? That's where it is. And if you look at it, we're doing some, again, phenomenal data crunching. And it will actually enable people to actually do things that they couldn't do before. It will not replace the person. We talk about man and machine, or woman and machine. You think about all that data, who can keep it in their head? Being a doctor. How can I keep all of the, you know, electronic medical records and all of the test results and all of the MRIs and all of the research that's been done, all the papers that have been written? How can I, when I'm looking at a patient in my office, put all of that together to come up with a diagnosis? It's hard. It's hard. Doctors are amazing at what they do. But when we now are looking toward personalized medicine, I want to know, you know, not just what the diagnosis is for the average person with this disease, but you and your genetic makeup, the exogenous data that surrounds you, where you grew up, what you eat, how you exercise, all of that data being ingested along with all the medical history to come up with a potential diagnosis. Now, just like it did on Watson, on Jeopardy, it'll come up with three potential diagnoses for a potential patient. The doctor still makes the decision. The doctor can drill down, why did you come, and by the way, not only what the potential diagnoses are, but the probability of that diagnosis, right? The doctor, though, goes deep, drills inside, understands how Watson came up with that recommendation, and then obviously makes the final recommendation here. But it is a way, I think, to be able to, you know, enable people to do things they've never done before. And so, again, I think this is the beginning of cognitive computing, and this will be taken into all these various industries. We're starting with healthcare. We're also looking at the financial sector, looking at education, right, and other industries as well here. So I think that, again, that's the first big shift, data, and what do we do with it? How do we get insight from it that can help us make better decisions, right, to make things better for ourselves and our world around us here? Okay, the second one is then cloud. And cloud here also, this cloud computing, right, you've all heard this, seen this, it offers a very flexible platform where you can add capacity very, very quickly. You can put new applications online very, very quickly. You can get up and running with new capabilities in a much faster way in a world that demands us to be faster and have more speed and innovation. And we see cloud also as another major shift in computing that will continue to accelerate. and have a huge impact, not just for developers and technology firms, but also for leaders in business, in higher education, and in government as well. And if I think about where we are here, you know, we also at IBM have been investing in cloud, but we're thinking about cloud for the enterprise. A lot of what you see today with cloud, whether it be Amazon or Azure or the others, are really more for consumers, right? When you start thinking about using cloud to run your business, where it's paramount to have the resiliency and, most important, the security of data, you really need to think about it in a different way. And I think that's the value add that we can bring to this equation here. And we've done a bunch of investments there, $1 billion to buy SoftLayer, which is our infrastructure as a service cloud offering here, and a lot more to come. So, you know, when we think about it again, it is it's about how do we bring the enterprise requirements into the cloud environment for a lot of the clients that are moving into that new space here. Okay, so data, cloud. The third area then is this shift around what we would call systems of engagement. Systems of engagement. Think about that as mobile and social. Mobile and social. So these technologies, social, mobile, they have completely changed the world, how the world works and how we as human beings interact with each other, day in and day out. And also with organizations, how they interact with each other. And I know you all see this every single day. On average, some of the statistics, we check out smartphones over 100 times a day. I don't know what we did with all that time before then. and it's hard to imagine that, you know, a technology in my lifetime at least that has had such a transformative impact as mobile and social has. How we communicate with our friends, with our family, how we shop, how we get news and information, how we learn, how we work. And our mobile devices have really changed everything and will continue to do so. Our customers are also responding to this phenomenon. So the enterprise customer, businesses, are saying, hey, you know, I got to be able to deal with the devices that our employees are bringing to the office. You can't just leave your smartphone home when you come to work, right? So how do I deal with it in an environment, in an enterprise that requires the security and the privacy of the data and the interactions that are required in those environments? In fact, 60% of companies now expect to devote more than a quarter of their IT spending to these new systems of engagement by 2016. So they all know they can't ignore it, they can't stop it, they got to embrace it. And they're putting their money where their mouth is. There are now more mobile smartphone users than desktop PC users, believe it or not, right? Which represents a whole new platform for computing. And as you might guess, IBM also is responding by investing very heavily in these new social and mobile technologies. And we're also transforming our own IBMers, our internal, you know, colleagues and employees here, through mobile and social engagements. We are, as I said, a very big organization, 400,000 IBMers. And I can tell you, the mobile and social are the way they're going to operate. It's the way they want to operate. It's the only way they want to operate. And so we have four generations of IBMers in the company now. The millennials are really pushing those of us who didn't grow up with some of these technologies to do things in new ways. And it's working for the better. It's going to bring us all into the future in a very, very more personalized way in what we do here. I'll give you one quick example. We started a program last year which we called the iFund IT. And it was patented after the Kickstarter app that's out there. So we provided some initial investment to support the development of our internal applications and projects. Instead of, you know, normally coming to senior management with your business case and your proposal and getting approved or not, we let our people decide. We let people in the company decide whether the proposal was a good one. And if so, they would be given some money out of the pool of money that we had here. And the employees would rank them, they would evaluate the projects, and they would then vote on which ones got funded. And it turned out to be a huge success. And this year we actually ramped up the pool of the budget dollars to provide to those ongoing recommendations and projects that are being funded here. So you see that this is where, you know, IBMers want to do this inside as well. They're using, and most of the apps, by the way, are mobile apps that they have built. That makes their day job easier. Access to information, real time, quick, right, with a quick mobile app here. So a whole new generation of innovators, again, are making their mark here. So those three, right? Data, cloud, systems of engagement. Now let me show you one of our rising new stars here. This is Lisa Seacat DeLuca. She is a young woman was the first woman, the first person actually in IBM in our history of 103 years to reach the 100 patent publishing plateau by the age of 30. She had 100 patents by the age of 30. First ever person in our history. She's a master inventor, and she has focused her creative and technical skills lately on the mobile app space here. And I'd like to show you just a very short video that will capture a day in Lisa's life, if I don't mess this up.
Good morning, guys. Being a parent changes your perspective on life. Like, all of a sudden, it's not just you, and it's not just your career that you're going to every day. You're doing something that you need to love because it's taking time away from your kids. I'm Lisa Seacat DeLuca, and I'm a mobile software engineer at IBM. I live in Baltimore, Maryland. I have a husband, Steve, and two twin boys, Anthony and Nathan. I like to write code. I also like to tinker with other technologies. I am the most prolific woman inventor at IBM. I hold over 120 patents. I have patents in email and instant messaging and mobile and social and cloud and data and GPS and RFID. If you can imagine it, you can patent around it.
Hey, it's Lisa.
I'll start with a Scrum call, typically at 10. And we noticed that there were four different things that we needed to work on with Cordova. And I can code around those meetings, so I can write the applications I need to do or contribute the open source back to Apache Cordova or work on the W3C specs that are out there. One of my mentors, she's a vice president and she has twins, and so that's how we connected. We started talking about careers and how what I could do could eventually lead to a career like hers. At 6 o'clock, my nanny heads home for the day, so my day is done. I get to be home with my kids and do what I love. One of my favorite things about working at IBM is they really do care about you as a person. You can move around and it's like you're changing companies. You have a whole new job. So I was in cloud for about 4 years and then decided, hey, I want to do mobile development. But I was able to shape my own career. I read an article recently about all these powerful women, and one of them was a 38-year-old CEO.
Good job.
I'm 31 now, so I have 7 years to get there.
I love you.
I love it. CEO by 38. By the way, I would not bet against her. She's really great. Okay. Data, cloud, engagement. Yep. But what has changed here on these three is not only have each of them been a driving force of foundational change, it is the integration of all of them, the confluence of all three of these things happening at the same time, that is just causing this fast-paced world of ours that we need to continue to stay ahead of, predict and stay ahead of, in order to be competitive in the market here. So let me just, if I could, spend a couple of minutes then talking about the types of leaders, because this rate and pace of change has an effect on the leaders of businesses and organizations as well. So I'd like to just spend my last couple of comments here on the types of leaders and thinkers that we need in order to exploit these new kinds of capabilities here. And then we'll get into lots of open, hopefully, discussion and dialogue here. So, leadership, the first one. I think the first is kind of obvious. And as I said earlier, if I had to give you one word for a promising area that I think all of us need to have some sense of, it's all around analytics. It's all around being able to garner the insight from the data that is just exploding around all of us here. There will be more than 4 million big data jobs by the year 2015 around the world. Incredible growth. And that's why IBM was also partnering with thousands of universities to teach more data scientists. Right? And we want to help lead in this age of analytics. Everyone is looking for these skills here. We're seeing tremendous demand from our clients, but we're also developing our own data scientists inside of IBM. I have that team on my team, and they work on a range of data projects internally. And then what we do, so we kind of, you know, help them get their hands-on experience. And then we move them out to work with clients and client engagements. And then we bring in the next, you know, the next round of folks, and we have them work on internal projects and then send them out again here. And I've worked with a lot of these. These are just phenomenally just brilliant folks here. They're sharp, they understand statistics, they also know how to apply statistics to solving real problems, real client problems here. And I always stress to them that, you know, there are something that is extremely important here, and I saw with Annie and others how you guys are doing it here. You have to make all of this consumable, because I might like statistics, you all might like statistics, but a lot of people don't. Their eyes glaze over, right? And, you know, when I was growing up learning statistics in OR, it was all about, you know, the numbers and the models and the Monte Carlo simulation. Now, you know, you have to be able to make them very consumable. And visualization is a big way to do that. Kind of make the insight pop out at you versus having to crawl through the data and the analysis here. So, in addition, it takes me to, it's not just what is it telling you? But it also, I think, bears on the kind of skills as a leader you need to have, and what we would call T-shaped skills. You need to be deep, right, in your core, whether that's civil engineering or statistics or, you know, you name it, science. But you also need to have these other skills, the top of the T, such as, how do you communicate what you've just created and invented? What does it mean? How do you bring people together in a collaborative way so you can actually get the best of everybody's thinking to solve a problem? How do you talk to a client, understand their challenges in their language? I'm a healthcare provider. I'm a retailer, right? How do we enable ourselves to be able to really engage with the customers, the users of our new capabilities here. So these T-shaped set of skills are very, very important. In fact, you know, in IBM, you know, we've got lots of people out there have deep skills. We're looking to the what really stands out in a person is the top of the T, the top of the T. It's the application of the technology. In fact, we talk about, I mean, we pride ourselves on our number of patents every year. We're the patent leader for many, many years in the world. But those are inventions that our great scientists and mathematicians and technical leaders have created, invented. Today we talk about innovation. Innovation is the application of an invention to solve a business problem or a world problem or a societal problem. And that innovation, I think, is really what will fuel the growth and the ongoing competitiveness of industries, of countries around the world here. So T-shaped skills here. You know, the other thing, this applied analytics, you see this applied in lots of different industries, as I mentioned. I think this ability, I mean, they're even using it in sports, right? In sports all over the place right now. Moneyball was one example, but just beyond that. In fact, we had done some work with a rugby team in Australia recently on analytics. And, you know, we used analytics in order to have them, their trainers, understand, you know, the seriousness of their injuries and what could predict that they were going to have a problem with a knee or with a shoulder or something else. And it honestly gave their trainers some heads-up advice. What started out as a team that was, you know, what was the number? 18 of the 35 players had serious injuries. They were at the bottom of their league. The next year, at the top of the league. Because they could take action ahead of time to prevent some serious injury that would knock the person out for the season there. So analytics can be applied to lots of different places and spaces. So leadership, analytics, but with a, you know, T-shaped way of how to describe it, consumable, so people understand it. Second point I think I'd make around leadership is that leaders today need to be collaborative. They need to bring teams together in a collaborative way. You know, the world I grew up with way back when was very much and I would say that the 20th century, you know, created companies where it was all the command and control, right? I say, the boss says this, and you say, yes, sir, and off you go. You don't ask why. Not today. Not today. It's a very collaborative environment. And by the way, not just because we want to be nice to each other, it's because that's how you get the best ideas, the best innovation. When a leader can actually bring people together, not just within their team, not just within their company, but within the broader ecosystem of partners, clients, other institutions. Bringing people together, having them listen to each other so that you're getting the best of everyone's thinking on the table, so that at the end of the day, when you're sharing ideas, you're actually getting a breakthrough result that says 1 + 1 = 2. That's how you speed up the time to the innovation and the impact of that innovation on the world or on your business or on yourself. Leaders have to be the ones bringing people together. We have competencies that we rate and rank our leaders against, and we talk about horizontal thinking this way, not just this way in your team, but this way, and collaborative influence. You've got to be able to bring people together to work together who don't report to you, right? But they're inspired by the opportunity to share ideas here. And I always say this is not consensus. When you bring people together to, you know, who have different opinions and experiences and backgrounds, you're not looking for consensus. I don't like that word. Consensus to me means least common denominator. That's not what we're looking for. We're looking for the best of everybody's thinking that ends up in a breakthrough, new idea, right? That's, I think, and I think that skill is going to be extremely important going forward here. By the way, you know, this next generation, you know, was born kind of in that world, very collaborative, with all of the technology and the capabilities that are out there. Don't lose that. Keep that, right? Leverage it, embrace it. And I guess the last thing I would leave you with here, I think, is... I think for every individual and every organization in the world today, you have to also be adaptable. As I kind of mentioned early on, just the skills you graduate with today may not be the skills you need 5 years from now. And you need to be able to recognize that the world is changing and you need to learn new things. We're going to be in a continuous learning throughout our careers going forward here. And the ability to recognize change is going to be your competitive advantage at the end of the day here. So again, I think as I think about that world, it means you have to embrace change, not fight it. Embrace it. And I would say that those companies, those organizations, those individuals who do embrace it are going to be the leaders, leading companies, leading individuals in this 21st century and beyond here. So, data-driven, collaborative, change agents. Fact-based, data-driven, collaborative, change agents, I think are some of the attributes of leaders of today and tomorrow here. So let me just stop there and kind of just, open it up if I could to questions and answers. Yep, thank you.